So we should stipulate at the start that Shaun's feeling a bit under the weather. He's got no thyroid, so it's kind of, you know, it's playing with your testosterone levels and your...
Well, that's permanent now. It's just that every now and then, every sort of few years, it goes wrong because as you're getting older, so you've got to put your levels up.
Yeah.
So it's just gone wrong, but, you know...
I'm just going to slide that in nice and close to you there.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Yeah, so if you hear me yawning, folks...
Yeah. It's not because I'm boring the shit out of him.
Matt's
hopefully.
Boring, no.
So my dad, Shaun, was born in Salford in 1964.
Oh, he's younger than me, you're
so old. So there's a real affinity and a kinship for me with this area of Manchester in particular.
Right.
But what he did was he got to 16 and he went off and joined the army,
right.
Went off and fought in Northern Ireland. And then after that, he paid his way through university down in Brighton, married my mum.
Yeah.
She got pregnant with me. They moved to the suburbs of Birmingham and he never looked back and he never went back. And I think from speaking to him and a couple of his family members, there's two reasons for that. I think one was it was a tough situation at home.
Yeah.
And he just wanted to get out of there. The other was, I guess, in the 80s, there was this big nationwide cultural shift, wasn't there, during Thatcher, to chasing well-paid jobs out in the suburbs,
absolutely.
Breeding loads, getting loads of stuff, and basically just feeding the economy. It was that kind of decade of consumerism, wasn't it?
I mean, in the early 80s, it was finished there. You know, late 70s and early 80s, it was finished. It was black and white in the 1970s, and then we sort of got colour in 1980. You know, and then by the sort of late 80s, it was unrecognisable, you know, and it's carried on since then.
Do you think part of that was the Cultural Revolution? Do you think that brought in a lot of creative types and also industry and commerce?
I mean, I don't know if this is just my perspective on it, right? It all sort of took off around the same time when the sort of the ecstasy thing hit. You know,
which is ironic, isn't it?
In the late 80s, the ecstasy thing hit, and then the sort of big telecom revolution and technology hit, and it really did turn Manchester into this sparkling, shiny sort of place, you know, and everything seemed to sort of come, you know, start happening around then, you know, and then obviously the 90s, and it's just gone on and on. I mean, Salford now, I mean, we've got the BBC here.
I know, I saw you on there.
Media City, and, you know, so it's...
You were on with Inspiral Carpets a few years back, weren't you? I think when you were promoting that tour, it was yourself, the two guys from Inspiral Carpets. One of them's obviously sadly passed on now.
Yeah. That's right. Yeah, well, I used to...
Maybe Rowetta was with you as well.
Since it's moved to Salford, I used to do the BBC News quite regularly, having to get to London for... 5 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
And I think since it's moved here, I've been on twice.
You just walk around the corner.
Yeah.
Can we take it back to your childhood, Shaun?
Yeah.
Where were you born specifically?
Little Alton.
Right.
Which is in Salford. It's not near Salford, it's in Salford.
And 63?
62.
Was the year? 62.
Yeah.
So for you, what was the first introduction to music? Were you in a musical family? Was it a musical household?
Well,
because I know the Beatles and the Stones have been a recurring influence in your lyrics and your music. And...
I mean, all the 60s music, really. I mean, I remember just growing up with fabulous, fantastic Radio 1, you know, which when you're a kid and you're in all these great sort of tunes, even all the Madison stuff. Radio 1 in the 60s was a big influence. So, yeah, and music, you know, my old bloke was pretty much Jim Royal. Banjo had come out, you know, accordion. And then it's really our cousins, the Carols, there was 11 of them, all at various ages, you know, going from, I think, our Matt's...
Oh, I've been told to say hello to your cousin Matt from my cousin, Lewis Smith.
Oh, right.
Who knows him?
Oh.
He did all the artwork, right,
yeah,
for the records back.
Yeah.
He's just had an exhibition, apparently, which
that's right. Yeah, with Amaria. So, I mean, the Carols being of different ages, you know, there was all sorts of different music going on with them lot, you know, from like some of the girls being into early Elton John, our Pete being into all these far out freaky, you know, Frank Zappa. Anything madness going on, and then Northern Soul and, you know, Motown, so everything really, you know, and then Top of the Pops and Bowie, so pretty much, you know, or Mud, you know what I mean? You know, everything.
Were you inspired by punk? Was that a movement
punk
that touched
you? Absolutely, cool. Well, punk, I mean, I got older punk in 77. Because
you were, I guess, at the right age, right? Teenager on it.
Or... Yeah, I wasn't a punk in 76. I mean, that was London. Yeah. You know what I mean? So, and it didn't last that long, really, with us in that sort of punk style of dress. The music lasted a lot longer.
I had Steve Diggle on the show last week.
Yeah, well, I know Steve Diggle. I'm getting, I thought you meant memory. See, it's happening already. Yeah, but yeah, Steve. I do know Steve. Custody, Buzzcocks Steve.
Yeah.
Buzzcocks was a big influence as well. You know, I was Joy Division. You know, I mean, all those Manchester bands from the 70s, you know. I remember the first time I ever saw Pete Shelley in town. You know, I was a post boy, really. I started being a messenger boy at 15,
right,
on the post, delivering telegrams, you know.
Did you leave school at that age?
Yeah. I was delivering telegrams, you know. I was telling people that they had to get, they was being evicted, or, you know, they had to go in and do a night shift at the trains.
Deliver a bad news, basically.
Yeah, and deaths and all sorts, wow. Yeah. I used to get a lot of that, and I'd walk in the pubs and, you know, have one on me, son. When you give me a telegram, you think I've got a fiver and somebody put a fucking Johnny in your pocket. So, I mean, it was really good because, as well, being a 15-year-old kid in Manchester, which in the late 70s, it was still pretty much like an episode of The Sweeney.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? It was still dreary, Victorian.
Drab.
Yeah, you know, black and white, smoky, you know, with lots of strippers. So, you know, we got to hang around, you know, in the strip clubs watching Bernard Manning doing, dinner time sessions with, mm-hmm, like, you know, old strippers and all that. Like, we were sat around having, you know, having a few pints and, you know, finish our break, go and deliver a telegram, go back to the pub, watch some more strippers. You know, it was great. It was one of my best times of my life, really. You know, being a 15-year-old kid in Manchester.
No responsibility.
Absolutely none, you know, except to get the telegrams delivered.
At what age did you start experimenting with alcohol? When was your first taste of booze?
Oh, I was on booze very, very early. You know, booze wasn't a problem in our house, you know, having a drink.
It was just accepted as
the norm. My granddad worked on the papers, and he used to come home at 5 a.m, you know, and he'd get dropped off by one of the vans or so, you know, somebody in a truck or whatever. And they'd just bring in crates and crates and crates of booze, you know what I mean, that he'd bought on the black market or whatever. And there was just booze stacked in their shed, you know, and there was no problem in us having a drink, you know, having a can of lager or whatever, you know. We didn't do wine, but, you know, it was allowed to have a can of lager, you know, being, you know, 13. But even, do you know what I mean? Even like having a sherry, a lot younger than that, you know.
Because a lot of people go out of the house to get drunk, don't they? Because their parents aren't obviously going to be too happy.
Oh, we used to
but
rape, you, you booze, were but we used to rob all right his booze, to just do it at you know home. What I mean? 10 years old, robbing his booze, yeah. You know, and he had all sorts. He had whiskies and ports and all sorts, you know. And we used to just drink him. And if he only had one bottle of it, we'd, like, fill it up with water, whatever it was, you know. And then so his pals would come round and the wives and that. And then he'd be, oh, he's not going for the chin, he said, no, it's water. No, he'd be pulling out. He was next thing, get your tongue. Oh, so yeah, you know. So I mean, the thing was, you know, I didn't grow up a boozer. You know, I mean, booze was around,
yeah,
and it's never been a problem. I mean, I got into the drugs.
Yeah, yeah.
You know. So,
well, we'll get there.
Yeah.
What would be a typical weekend for you around age sort of 13, 14,
oh, boozing,
then, as a teenager?
Boozing, that was girls. It. Clothes, you know, boozing, girls' clothes, and on the pursuit of money.
Right, and what would that involve?
What money?
Yeah, I mean, how would you go about trying to get it?
All sorts.
Put us in the picture.
Oh, we used to do off licenses. We used to do pubs. You know, I mean, houses. You know. Through bathroom windows, and you know, and we knew who was working nights,
right?
You know,
so you knew when to go, where to go.
You know, so you know, I mean, I used to get one of the adrenaline buzzies I was addicted to as a young kid was crawling along somebody's bedroom floor while they was sleeping. You know, a worker sleeping. You know, and drunk and crawling along and getting the wallet out of the pants.
So you wouldn't even just go downstairs and maybe lift some
we'd go where
crockery
the
or you'd go right up to the bedroom whilst they're in there asleep.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Nice.
Buzz.
Did you ever get arrested as a kid?
A few times, yeah. My first criminal offence that put me on the radar was I was riding on my bike, which is now Salford Town Hall, right? And past there at Swinton, and I'm going past, and the precinct's on the right-hand side, so, and then this copper waves me over, and he stood on Fountain Square, where the fountains was. So I rode over to him, and he said, "You fucking been riding that bike on the pavement all over the place." I said, "Not. I've not rode a bike on the pavement. I've just been blind, you know, told him whatever I'd done." He said, "No, you've just rode it right now," right? When I rode over to him, and I got nicked and took to court and put on a criminal record because of that.
Wow.
You know, and I was put on a 12-month, whatever it was, can't remember. So, yeah, that started that. I was at court, and that's how I got, you know.
Yeah. At that point, then you sort of think, well, if you're going to treat me as a criminal, I'm going to just behave like one.
Do you know what? I didn't even. I just was. I mean, I was already scallying about anyway. You know, I mean, a lot of our neighbours was police. I knew, you know, some of our pal. I mean, as you know, two of the Happy Mondays' dads was police.
So, how did the band form? The original lineup, obviously pre-Bez, just the original. Was it five of you?
Yeah, I mean,
yourself, your brother Gary.
I mean,
Paul and Mark.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. Well, including Bez, they all went to the same school.
Oh,
we
okay.
went to the Catholic school, me and our Paul. They went to the Church of England school, which is, you know, about a mile up the road. So, but we all lived around the same area.
And what age did you start jamming and actively going, right, we're going to be a band, we're going to do this music?
I was 18. And Gaz Whelan, Paul Davis was still at school. Mark was my age, and now Paul would have been 16.
Right.
So, yeah.
And this is 1980, that had been?
Well, let me see, 18. So I was born in 62. Yeah, 1980.
1980. Mm. So, what were you doing for... Because the debut album was 87.
Yeah.
Right, what were you doing for 7 years? Just literally mucking about?
I think we actually made that in 86, I think.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure we made that in 86. What would you do? What would you know what? We made a couple of singles before. I think the first single came out, I'm not dead on it, but I think it was around 84. It was well too soon for us to be on vinyl. Well too soon. I mean, we you know, it's that old one, isn't it? It's not... What you know, it's and also this stuttering thing is because of the thyroid. Rango, when
the little lizard thing
stops in the middle of a sentence and goes like that and then doesn't speak. Well, that's what happens when your thyroid as well. With my thyroid, I go and then the stuttering starts. So calm down, let the beta blocker work.
Do you want some water? You got plenty of water over there, yeah? Does that help being hydrated?
Yeah. So what was I saying? See, memory again. It's terrible,
isn't it? So you formed the band in 80.
We should have done it. I'll be absolutely fine in about another 3 weeks' time when we get these meds sorted out.
Oh, no, yeah, we 1980. Should have done it then.
So we did a couple of singles, and it was that old one. It's not what you know, it's who you know.
Yeah.
You know, and we knew Phil Sachs. You know, Phil Sachs owned the market stalls where we got the jeans from and stuff, and we hung around, you know, Phil's store. And Phil... You know, liked us. We was decent lads. He liked us, and we liked music. He was a DJ at the Twisted Wheel a few years earlier.
Wigan, right? Was that Wigan? No, Wigan Casino. Twisted Wheel was Manchester.
Twisted Wheel was a club
was
in Manchester.
Northern Soul Club.
Yeah,
though, right?
Yeah. So Phil was a DJ there a decade, you know, before, or two decades before, I think we met him. And Phil was best friends with Mike Pickering, Tony Wilson, Rob Gretton, you know, they was all pals. So because of meeting Phil, then Phil, you know, called in a couple of favours to them lot. And before we knew it, we was making singles, which was just way too soon, you know. I mean, really, I mean, I got the job as songwriter because I was the best at it, you know.
Best of a bad bunch at that stage.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, none of them, you know, they couldn't, they all had a go. And it was just terrible, really, really, including my standards back then. And So, yeah, I got the job as a songwriter. So, you know, you got to learn your craft. And the first songs, you know, was you know, well embarrassing. You know, was
singing, are they out there? Are they available?
Some of them are, you know, especially the one about Vietnam and Saigon.
Right.
So, dude. Hilarious.
Very topical in 1982.
Oh,
yeah.
You know what I mean? So, but oh, some of the subject matters, you know. So, yeah, some of them are out there. And
I bet they fetch a you know, a pretty penny.
Yeah, I mean, yeah,
the vinyls.
A few quid.
You should buy them all up and burn them.
Yeah,
bury the evidence.
Yeah, absolutely.
At what age did you start going to the Hacienda and performing there?
Well, the Hacienda opened in '82.
Right.
And I mean, from the date it was opening, we went to the Hacienda. I mean, the thing about the Hacienda was.
Was it a live band venue predominantly?
Yeah, it was a live band venue, you know, and it was, you know, there was music night, you know, what would you call it? Club nights, yeah. Right? But there was empty. The Hacienda, apart from when there was a band on there, you know, and everyone, we saw everyone there from Simple Minds, Smiths, New Order, everything that was going on, Orange Juice, you know, that was, you name it, Madonna turned up there, you know, that was at the time we saw everyone there, but the Hacienda was completely empty. When it wasn't a gig night on there, and it was just a club night, there was nobody in that club. Nobody. It didn't fill up till '87. Again, with the old, you know, the
rave culture.
The
coming
rave
in.
Culture, yeah.
What do you remember about the first album? That was with John Cale, right?
Yeah,
that's a pretty big name and a huge talent to be working with at that stage in your career,
yeah.
Right?
I mean,
what did you learn from working with him?
Well, John, really, I mean, when you think about the sort of that time in the 80s, I think John had probably just got himself straight.
Right.
And all I remember about John is he had shed loads of tangerines, you know, and watched Channel 4 News, you know, and then there's this bunch of fucking totally dickhead northerners. You know, and actually that was a favour as well because Tony Wilson was mates with John Cale and I think John produced our album for, it was either $4,000 or $6,000.
Wow.
You know.
Mates rates.
Yeah, mates rates. I mean, and that was our, you know, first time really, you know, well, it was our first time making an album. And we'd only been in the studio a couple of times before, you know, and I was still fascinated, like, you know, in the drum booth, and I spent like 2 hours going, have you heard this tin can when you bang it with a drumstick in here? You know what I mean? It was like, wow. So he was so
literally
naive.
Kids in a toy
shop.
Yeah,
absolutely, yeah, yeah.
And he was obviously a huge.
Well, then he had to work with us, you know what I mean? There was only one of us that knew what key things was. You know, Mark had to tell everyone else what key we're in. You know, I mean,
was he patient with you?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, what John did really was just press play and record and just pretty much got us as we was live, you know, did a few overdubs and that was it. It wasn't, you know, he just, you know, pretty much that's how that first album was pretty much how we sounded live.
And what's the title? What's that all about? Squirrel and
Squirrel
G-Man.
Well, Squirrel and G-Man was the keyboard player's parents.
Right.
He was G-Man. She looked like a squirrel. Squirrel and G-Man, 24-hour party people, plastic face, can't smell. That was us lot, you know, on the powders and never going to sleep. Obviously the whiteout was, I mean, you know, cocaine was expensive, dude, you know. Well, it was the same price back then as it is, you know. In fact, it's cheaper now, isn't it? So, not that annoying. I've been retired for quite a few years now.
It was in the 80s, it was very much the drug of the celebrities, the rich people, the upper class, wasn't it?
I mean, it was 80 quid a gram, you know, wow. 60 or 80 quid a gram, you know, which was.
What were we talking in, say, wages relatively at that point, what you were, say, making from.
Oh, I would have been earning that. If I was still working then at the post office, I wouldn't have earned that in a week. Yeah, well, I wouldn't have come out with that after, you know, your tax or whatever.
So what sort of narcotics were flying around whilst the debut album was getting made? Was it cocaine? Was it, was that? What
bits
was
of Charlie. Certainly we hadn't hit the E then. A lot of speed and shitloads of...
marijuana.
Yeah, and ash, yeah. Well, even ash, really, because, I mean, you know, it mainly was. I mean, you know, obviously picked up weed, but it was like a lot of dirt weed going around and stuff. It wasn't, you know. I mean, in fact, one of the first, I can remember, you know, in sort of about 87, you know, when we went to the States, I brought a load of growing gear back with us. There was no lamps over here or anything then that you could just go and buy. We brought shitloads back with us from the States and grew fucking loads of it. I think it was one of the first bits of skunk that hit Manchester, that.
Claim to fame. Yeah. Another for the list.
In Granby House, fucking block of flats, stank. You know, it was me and about 15 prostitutes in that block of flats.
What age did you move out of home and get your own place?
Well, own place. I mean, I pretty much started from being when I was like 15 and working. I said, see you to my mum, you know, and then she might see me about, you know, 3 weeks later. You know,
were they supportive of the musical endeavours?
Oh yeah, absolutely.
That makes the world a difference,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. I mean, my dad, really. I mean, my old bloke was, you know, he was a bloke who drove us and set up our gear, you know, and you know, I mean, some of his amps and stuff, you know, it was his gear that we used to borrow.
Good on your dad.
You know, my old bloke did the clubs and stuff.
Yeah, yeah. And were they aware of the partying that was going on, or did they kind of...
I mean, Dad was there all the time,
was he,
you know.
Getting involved, or...?
There. If my mum was not listening to this, yeah, I mean, you know, of course he did, yeah. Yeah. You know, I mean, it's sort of, you know, working with my old bloke, I mean, you know, we've spent years with him. It sort of ruined my relationship with him for a while, you know what I mean? 20 years on the road, I mean, it's like, it's just... Because you're spending so much time together, you know. I mean, the first time we ever played Wembley Arena.
Yep.
And my dad was doing backline and stuff, and I can't hear on stage, and I'm saying, I can't fucking hear you, silly cunt. And the next thing, in front of 10,000 people, my dad walks up to me and smacked me right in the nose, bang, nose goes, right, and everyone there, whoa! Oh, you know, because I called him a silly cunt.
That's the start to the show.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, Nathan sacked him. Our manager at the time was Nathan McGough. And Nathan said, I can't have that, Derek. That can't be going on.
Do you wish, in a way, that you were still on Factory Records with no record contract?
No. No. I mean, look, Factory's great. He was great then. And I really did, through being so spoiled, in a way, with how free you can be and how... Just, you know, ideas that you come up with are let room. I mean, imagine if I was on, you know, fucking Sony or Warner's or Universal and that, you know, and we're one of the sort of major bands on that label, and we go, look, you know, we've got this guy, he's a DJ, and we want him to do an album. He's never done one before, you know what I mean? But he DJs, he's got, you know, he does London, he's out in Ibiza, and we want him to, and an album that they're waiting for to, you know, boost the income for, you know, the company. And they just said, fuck off.
No way.
You know,
no way.
But, you know, yeah. With ease, like, it was like, well, let's have a, you know, let's listen. So, yeah.
And you're talking there about Paul Oakenfold.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's go to album two before we go to that one, Bummed. Tell us about the title there as well.
Bummed. Well, what Bum really is, you know, at the you know, it was just any, you know, it was just saying, really, you know, fucking, instead of kicking someone's head and getting him fucking bum you. You know, or, you know, or the album, you know, it could be anything, or, you know.
I mean, it's not a sexual reference then?
It isn't. But the thing about the Americans is they thought it meant the album's bummed, you know. It's so they didn't want it called that, not for any sexual reference, just that because it was like saying, you know, calling an album this is a load of shit, or it's going to do, you know.
Lost in translation.
Yeah, you know, so, yeah.
And that was with the genius, the Phil Spector of Manchester, Martin,
yeah, yeah. Yeah,
I was speaking to Steve about him because he did
great.
Spiral Scratch, their first EP.
Yeah,
and he was obviously integral to that whole sound, really, wasn't he? And
the... oh god, the drum sound of that—he's on it, isn't it? You know, I mean, I think pretty much. I mean, Steve might disagree, but as far as I know, I mean, that yeah, it's Martin's sound.
What did he bring to the table? Because it was a lot
of
electronical experimentation, right, and reverb, and
yeah.
What was it like working in the studio with him? I mean, did he have a similar work ethic to you guys in the sense that he was a madhouse?
When he went to party, Martin, you know, Martin, we was babies compared to Anna.
Right.
Hell, you know, I mean, you know, Martin.
Was that one of the last albums he did? Because he passed away a couple of years later, didn't he?
A good few years later, yeah, yeah. He'd been out on a session with our Matt, actually, and died. So, no, Martin, you know, he was great. He brilliant. I mean, what he did, Martin, really, was like kind of like you say, Phil Spector or George Martin. You know, he was, oh, let's get strings on and let's do this. You know, I mean, again, sort of. Pretty much, we played live, you know, and he billed, you know, on all sorts.
There's a song on that record. I'm trying to, I think it's Mad Cyril.
Yeah.
Are you referencing performance in that when he's saying, I like that, turn it up.
Yeah.
And it's that bit where the guy's in his pants air drumming when he's out of his head, isn't he, in the film?
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's a lot. I mean, I did take a lot from performance, you know. It was sort of, you know, I mean, it's...
It's a great fucking movie.
Oh, it's brilliant. You know, I mean, that really is, you know, Brian Jones's life at the time. You know, the sort of all the circumstances that Brian died in and everything. It's pretty much that, you know, without saying this is Brian Jones, that was pretty much what was going on at Brian Jones's house.
Yeah.
You know, and I know that from people on the inside.
And that was obviously around the time people started remixing your stuff, which I guess tied in exactly with the...
With the old
the
Acid House scene and all that.
Of Acid House. Yeah. I mean, you guys were right on the front line. Did you align yourself with that scene? Were you...
It was, again, with us, it was the pills, you know. Right. I mean, again, sort of loving all sorts. I mean, it's like at the end, I mean, when if you know, the end of the rock and roll swindle, and that was what? That came out in, what, 78 or something? McLaren goes, punk's dead, it's now dance, disco. And he was fucking right. Like a lot of things, Malcolm, he was right on that. I mean, the next biggest thing really after that was, the, you know, 10 years later, the old club scene.
Hip-hop, I guess, and then club culture, yeah.
And then the
rave
scene, you know, and he was right. It was bang on that. You know, I mean, you know, it's like, you know, sort of all the northern soul scene and everything. I mean, you know, we'd always... And dance music, I mean, as well as all the stuff that I grew up with, it was, you know, I mean, I was more into hip hop, you know, and Public Enemy and stuff, you know, than
great
loads
band.
Of indie bands.
Yeah.
You know, so I mean, it's just that what it was when the Ecstasy hit is, you know, you'd be getting Oakenfold mixing in wooden tops, you know, with, you know, Spanish or Italian, you know, 100 beats a second stuff or whatever, 10 million beats a second tackle, you know, Yeah, I've done that thing again, like
right.
Rango.
What about Carl Denver? What do you remember about him?
Tony Wilson loved Carl Denver. And something happened to me at the time, and I needed some dough. And Tony said, look, if a guy called Carl Denver, we want him on, I think he should be on this track. He said, and if you say yeah, I'll give you this money. And all as I knew about Carl was Wimaway. Anyway, went over to Jersey to meet Carl, and he was great, you know, great bloke. And you know, we did Lazy Itis with him.
Did you do a video for that song?
We did, yeah. We made that at this. I think it's now a bit of a skateboarding thing going on down at the bottom of London Road in town, going to Hardwick. And it was then a little football, five-a-side football thing, and that's where we filmed it. I had a rain machine, because there was actually no fucking rain in Manchester
for once,
you know what I mean? So, yeah, I had this rain machine and filmed it there, you know. I think it cost us, you know, that video cost about $2,000 to make.
Now, is this a rumour, or did he get pneumonia from the shoot?
Who, Carl?
Yeah.
I don't think he did.
Right. It's one of those stories that...
Yeah, yeah. Because, I mean...
Does the rounds. There seems to be a lot of them surrounding
you. Oh, God,
sure.
Yeah, there is, yeah.
What's the most absurd thing you've ever heard about yourself that isn't true?
Oh, do you know what?
Because there are too many to list.
Fucking loads, you know. I mean, loads. I mean, some of them are, just fucking loads. But, I mean, it's like, you know, you just let it go. You know, I mean, you can't... I just... You know, fucking hell, forget it.
Were you ever sort of aware when you got thrust into the public, I guess, would Bum have been around the time you began being a public figure, or would that have been with Pills, Thrills and Bellyache?
It's really, I think it was it was Pearl's. I mean, we once I'll tell you one, right, really. Once we did Top of the Pops, then when we did Top of the Pops, if you was on Top of the Pops, you was fair game then for any of the normal press.
Yep.
And I remember at the time, you know, nobody liked speaking to Piers Morgan. It's Piers Morgan's son, you know. And us, you know, we use. I mean, I get people saying, oh, yeah, he must be really pissed off with the drug thing and all that, you know, getting in the way of the music. The thing was, we used what we had. You know, there was loads of bands about at the time that, you know, you don't hear them now. And we just used what we had. I mean, we found out early doors that if some guys from the Melody Maker NME came to interview us, you know, and there was going to be a piece about 2 inches, you know, long, in the paper, in the NME or the Melody Maker, and we found out really by accident by someone either chopping out a line on the pool table or skinning up, and the next thing it's a fucking centre spread with loads of photos because, you know, we'd had a line and skinned up a joint, and it was like, okay, right, let's do that then, you know. So the next thing, you know, the headlines got bigger and you know, the joints got bigger and the lines got fatter, just playing it, you know, and that, you know, so we got more centre spreads and, you know, so great.
I spoke to...
You know, it's like, again, with Piers. Everyone was avoiding Piers Morgan. It's Piers from the Sun. All right, lads, all right, Piers, how you doing? Hey, do you want to come and meet Ronnie Biggs? Yeah, of course we do. And we actually knew the fella who Ronnie was with, a fella called Tim. And so we all went over there and, you know, got on with Piers and we're in the Sun then.
Was that when you went to Rio?
Yeah.
Yeah. Tell us about that trip.
Oh, God, I can't, you know what, I mean, there's lots of things that happened on that trip, you know, fucking hell, but, yeah.
What was Ronnie like?
Ronnie was great, you know, he was great, yeah, he's sort of like, oh, you're a Leo like me, you know, hey, oh, we've got our birthdays around at the same time, you know, so he was, yeah, he was all right, you know. I mean, and the Pistols had done it all before.
Of course, know? Yeah, yeah.
And I mean, that's good enough for John's, good enough for me, that's why I'm here.
I think there's a lot of similarities with you guys in the way of, I guess, the Filth and the Fury and the Scandal, which followed you, seemed to be very much the story of the Sex Pistols' career early on when they came out. And then you sort of had Tony and Malcolm, these similar kind of figures.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
There's definitely a lot of parallels, isn't there?
Yeah, I mean, you know, but again, we really did play it, you know, because, you know, you know, I mean, look, when you get into music and we got into being in a band, we didn't get into... I mean, a lot of kids now, they go into things because for the money.
Mm-hmm.
And if you just go
and
you get dough, or the fame, just for that, you're never going to do fuck all. And one of the things we sort of left out when we was thinking and visualising, you know, was, you know, we never fucking thought about the making dough from that. You know, you made money other ways, and if anything, you got paid for any of that, that was a fucking bonus,
yeah.
You know. And we never really thought about money or fame. I mean, once we'd sort of got into it, you know, like, we want the press, you know, so that's what all that sort of culture with the drugs came in for, you know. I mean, at the end of it, you know, oh, you're still alive. It's like, well, yeah, of course. I mean, I was never a needle freak. I never stuck needles in my arm. I smoked coke and dropped teas and a load of weed. You know what I mean? I didn't do fucking needles. Never got abscesses and shit like that, you know. So, you know, and in the junkie circle, that makes you a shitbag. You don't do needles.
Yeah, a shit junkie.
Yeah, you know.
You're still alive to tell the tale, so.
Fancy, like, well, I'm fucking better than you are because I stick needles in my arm. Fuck you, now.
Here's a question for you, Shaun. What do you think is the reason why, because for me, as sort of working in the music now, you don't see any working class bands anymore.
You do, but they're in the grime scene.
Right.
That's where
they are. That's a fair point, yeah.
You know, that's it. It's like, because at the time when we was doing what we did, you know, for a start, when we started, white guys didn't do rap music. You know, Beastie Boys had just come along. You could get away with that in America, you know. And white guys didn't do that. I mean, now you do what you want, and that's great, but you didn't. So, you know, what we did then, which was cool and, you know, right on, was the indie sort of side of things, which sometimes meant indie meant just plain shite. You know what I mean? And other times it meant absolutely groundbreaking, fucking brilliant. And so we, you know, that was indie, and now it's a grime scene. I mean, the thing is still, it's in a way, it's still not changed. I mean, there's some great grime artists about and young kids that are really good and not the fucking dickheads that are writing about how many Rolexes you've got and I went to got dropped off in a fucking white Beamer and picked up in a black Beamer, you know what I mean? I not Beamer, my Benz. you know, I've got fucking, you know, wedges of money in that. I mean, that's just bullshit. But there's some fucking great writers. Really, I mean, I used to buy them sort of CDs where they had about, you know, 15 different kids on from all over the place you'd never heard. I mean, listen, I go, that's fucking great. I mean, a lot of them, majors are scared to death of those kids. You know what I mean? It's like, if you're too real, you're too real for them. And they're frightened to death of you and they don't understand you because you're too real. And then all they'll do then is go and get something that that will do with what they're told. And it's a watered-down version.
Watered-down version, yeah.
You know. But there are some, you know, there's some people who know how to play the game. There always will be and has been.
There doesn't seem to be, if we're talking specifically guitar-based music, though, there doesn't seem to be any for me.
No, there isn't.
Working class, or as you say, real, yeah. Raw.
Well, there's not, I mean, because... I suppose... The only way, if you sort of see music moving forward, instead of it being old style music, is going through that hip hoppy grimy sort of thing. You know, even though shitloads of that's done before, it seems to move forward. You know, it's new, and until somebody comes up with how to do something completely different and groundbreaking, doing rock or, you know, guitar or whatever, then that's when we'll probably get something.
So Pills, Frills and Bellyaches, that is...
That was our pop album.
That's a defining statement right there, isn't it?
Well,
Are you proud of that album above...
Look, what we had to do, right, really, was we had to make... It's all right making indie albums, you know, and this and that. But if you want to sort of start keep doing what you're doing or your art, you've got to start making some dough, you know, and that seems to be sort of doing, you know, becoming a bit more commercial.
Is that how you look back at it now then?
Yeah, a bit more of a bang on what's happening as well, really. That's why we got the sort of, you know, we wanted Oakenfold in because of, you know, what was going on with the dance street. So
he was right on the point with a lot of stuff, wasn't he? He was actually an agent, I was reading, and a promoter for Run DMC and the Beastie Boys, like early on at the start.
He was into all sorts of folk. He still is, isn't he? You know, so yeah.
And he signed Salt and Pepper, I read.
Did he?
Yeah, and DJ Jazzy Jeff the Fresh Prince.
You see, I've never quizzed him, and I've never read his book. You know what I mean? Read bits of his book, and never quizzed him. Well, it's not his book, is it? But someone else wrote it.
He's credited as an arranger as well as like a producer, mixer, engineer on the record. Did he help you a lot with the song structures and with the writing?
On Pills and Frills, right, really. This is where it goes different now. We'd sort of before gone in, bashed out, gone in rehearsals, bashed through tunes. We went in with Pills and Frills with, I think, two tunes. What I wanted was Oakenfold to throw a shitload of beats down, which is what he did, and then you put some bass to that, and you and put some guitar on that, and that's what Pills and Frills was, and that was our breakthrough commercial album.
And it was done in LA, right?
Yeah.
What do you remember about being out there?
LA was, you know, I mean, it wasn't our first time going to LA, but it was certainly our first time living there for a while, you know, more than a few days and then moving on, or a couple of days and moving to somewhere else. So we you know, we plotted up there for, you know, I don't know, 8 weeks or something, I'm not sure. And we stayed on Oakwood Apartments, which is a place where a lot of porno stars lived and people whose actors are, you know, movies, TV and other musicians. You know, it was like a very sort of posh Butlins. You know, you get there, you looked at this list and a picture of what you wanted in your room. I'll have two dishwashers, three microwaves, a big telly, and then pick your ornaments, you know what I mean? And within about half an hour, a load of Mexicans had picked all that stuff up, put it all in your place, fucked off, and, you know, you're picked apart. So it was great, wasn't it? We all had swimming pools outside and, you know, jacuzzis. And then, you know, turn down time outside was something like 11 o'clock, you know, which obviously got us into a bit of trouble. But everyone was, you know, partying there.
Did you meet any, you know, musicians or actors? Did you go out on the radio?
Yeah, I mean,
with...
well, I think, yeah. Utno was there, you know, was, well, from Artie, and obviously, you know, it was like, you know, two sort of actors who would, you know, from England. But and then there was just loads of, you know, Americans, you know, from bands and pornos and stuff that we sort of can't, I can't remember.
Okay, final Black, final Mondays album, and then we'll talk Black Grape.
Okay,
and
okay.
We'll talk, I saw you recently live as well with The Verve. You were opening up for them
oh,
in Birmingham.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I got to see some of the new songs.
Oh, what
and
do you think?
I thought they're fantastic, mate. Yeah, I just thought they seamlessly stood right side by side with the old stuff. Was that sort of the intention?
Yeah,
that
I mean, record, I actually think we bettered that first album, you know, because, you know, I mean, again, me and him was great, right together, fantastic, me and Kermit, you know, I always did. And but we had so much going on back in the day, you know, it was almost writing was secondary, you know. You know, we had fucking heroin habits to keep and stuff, so, you know.
Were you both on it together?
Oh, yeah, yeah, that's how we met. That's right. Well, we didn't, we became pals because we were smack buddies.
Right.
You know, we was both, he was on the rap scene, you know, which is in Manchester, you know, and everyone knows each other, you know, and music, you know, where it goes in the same places and clubs.
Yeah, yeah.
And that. So, and then we started palling about just because we was smack buddies.
But you said you never injected, so it was always smoking, was it?
No, I didn't. He did.
He did.
He ended up with fucking a pig's valve in his heart and last rites being told to him a couple of times, you know. You know, he's just got his new pig's valve in, you know, because he had got
sex. He looked great on stage the other night.
He's, you know, I mean, you know, look. He's 51 years old, and we're out, and people still think he's 20 fucking nine.
Yeah, yeah,
you know
yeah.
I mean? So
I was surprised that when I was reading up about him that he is that old.
Mm.
But you're looking great as well. You're looking really good.
Yeah, yeah. Oh.
Are you still drinking or not?
I do have.
You indulge in the occasional.
I don't have booze at home.
Right.
I'll still have a drink.
But that's it. That's your only vice.
Yeah.
How long did it take you to kick the heroin?
Oh, God. Well, when he hit 40, he was like, look, dude, I shouldn't be even doing fucking, never mind, just heroin, all of it, the lot, even smoking weed. He was like, I shouldn't be doing any of this. I don't want to be doing it. And 40, you know, it's like, fucking hell, because I had a bad time when he hit 40. I thought, fuck me, you know, 40. He was like, whoa. Of course, by the time I hit 50, it was fucking great. You know what I mean? I got even more comfortable in my fucking skin. Didn't need to hide behind in drugs anymore or whatever. But, yeah, so, I mean, it took me about, from 40, I started on it. And it took me 5 years to get clean.
5 years,
yeah.
Wow.
You know, I mean, I ended up, you know, really, I mean, I'd done rehab so many times, never worked for me, just personally for me. And eventually I got on my bike at 5 o'clock in the morning and stayed on it every night till about 10 or 11 or 12 o'clock at night.
Where's this?
In the Peak District.
Right.
Although, you know, just cycling, like, fuck. And, you know, cycled through on the pain barrier and bullshit and hooked up again with my fantastic missus who blew me out back in the day, you know, and, yeah, the rest is...
She helped you through it a lot,
oh,
did
yeah,
she?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. History, you know, yeah.
Love it.
Ah,
and I guess you had all that shit with the management company going on. Was that at the
same time as kicking the drugs? That went on for 12 years. I mean, I had 100% of my income in receivership. So I ended up in receivership because I wouldn't pay the Nicholses their 150 grand. Right? I just wasn't going to pay them. I should have won that court case. And because of the head I had on and the age that I was, it was like, fuck off. Anyway, so that ended up... going into untold, fucking, and it lasted for 12 years, you know, and I couldn't go bankrupt, you know, if I could, I would have had no problem doing that, but I couldn't because you lose all your writing royalties.
Right, everything's gone.
You never get it back.
And as an artist and a musician, that's your pension, that's your life, isn't it?
So it took me 12 years to get, and I fucking hate receivers. They're the biggest robbing cunts going. You know, and all they've got to do, they'll never tell you how much you've got, you know, and then they just take 100% of your income, right? So you can't then pay tax on it because they don't pay the fucking tax. They take 100% off you and don't pay your tax. How are you supposed to do that?
So then at the end of that 12 years, you're hit with a 12-year tax bill,
are you? Oh, you've
got
to then go to tax lawyers, you know, and do all that and everything. Fucking hell. So, you know, 12 years and... And I finally got Brian Fugler, who's a guy who sorted Georgie Best out. And Brian went and did a deal on the golf course, and we got out of it. Nobody else could do it. So, yeah. So, yeah, I had to deal with all that. I mean, the way I dealt with it was just stick my head in drugs.
Yeah. Well, it's sort of understandable, really, isn't it? Because that's a fucking shit situation to be in.
I mean, you see, the thing is, as well, you get knocks on the door like, what are you doing here? And now you're paying that electric bill. And now you're paying your rent. You know what I mean? You're in a fucking terraced house in the ass end of nowhere. And they want to know how you're paying your electric bill. You know, because they really want
to show up unannounced.
They wanted you in a box under the motorway. You know?
How did you begin to find your way out of that? Financially?
Financially?
Yeah, was it just reforming the band and getting back out on the road?
Well, it didn't matter. It's not that I could earn money. I just couldn't keep it.
Right.
And I'm, you know, and as you know, in anything like this, it's read at the tax office. It's, you know, so anyway, you know, you can earn, but you can't keep. And then, there's no point in going doing stuff, but, you know, you do certain things and blah, 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 blah. So, you know, it's a fucking mess. So, but, you know, it's hard to get out of. It really is hard to get out of.
You've led quite the life, haven't you, Shaun? Do you have any regrets? Because I know some people go, it's made me who I am today.
Yeah, well,
and
it has. It's made me who I am today. Look, it's not that I've got massive big regrets. I mean, of course I've got regrets on certain things. These certain things that if I could change, I would, but you can't. You know, but, you know, all in all, I'm all right. I'm not bitter. You know, not
because that, you carry that with you everywhere you go, don't you? Of mind, it's a weight and it brings you down and it brings people around you down.
Maybe I'm just too fucking stupid to be bitter, you know what I mean? I just don't give a fuck.
You got a positive ray about you, that's what it is. The Last Mondays album, let's quickly touch on that. Are you sort of a fan of that?
No,
are you proud
no,
of that?
No. I mean, again, look, you know, it's
we're teaming Chris happened, the wrong people the time, to produce the album, do you think?
Well, I wanted Oakenfold and Osborne. Now, obviously, after, you know, Pills and Frills, it went to number two in the album charts, there was a lot of press with it. And Oakenfold and Osborne was the next thing. You two wanted them, and they wanted them, this and that, right? So they was obviously busy. Now, all as he said was, look, yeah, we'll do the album, but you're going to have to wait because we got these commitments. So some of our lot was like, we fucking made them, you know what I mean? They should drop what they're doing, you know? And the next thing, Chris and Tina, who are fantastic producers, don't get me wrong, and brilliant, you know, talking heads, and they've done some amazing stuff, right? But it wasn't right for what I wanted to do. To me, that album is just, you know, it's a very poor Talking Heads album as far as I'm concerned. You know.
It definitely took the edge off the band, didn't it?
Well, you know, I mean, this is what the big arguments is about. And they wanted that. They wanted to go with them and not wait. And then when it wasn't a hit and it didn't, you know, it didn't do what it was wanted it to do, it was my fault and Bezzy's fault. You know, and that caused a lot of bullshit. You know, now, you know, we're all old blokes. You know, there's no bullshit that comes, you know, like it is when you're young with us lot. You know, it's and we're playing better than ever before, you know, and we, you know, we get on, you know, and we go and play. The thing is, when you're doing interviews like this and you want to be truthful, and the next thing one of them will read something, you go, you want you fucking starting that again, you cunt? Because, you know, egos with musicians.
Well, it's a difficult political minefield when there's several members, and I guess you've all got equal say, is that right?
Yeah, I mean, I see that's the thing about the Mondays. You know, you've got Rowetta, and then you've got six lads. Right, but you've got Bez, and you've got R. Paul, and you've got Jazz Whelan, and Mark, and they, you know, because the thing is, because we've all been sort of pals since we was, you know, kids, and it's still that mentality of, you know, you can't tell me what to do, right? You know, it's a sort of thing. So, you know, so now, you know, it's like, whereas we ended up doing a Black Grape album because it's just me and Kermit. Fans doing an album? Yeah, how are you? Oh, he's great. Fucking let's get it. I know should we produce. Who won't produce it? Oh, let's go and do it. With the Mondays, it's, where is he? Oh, is he? Right. What's he doing? What's that? Where is he? He's coming over from LA and he's coming over from Canada and then he's doing this and doing that, you know. So it's, you know, takes fucking time to organise stuff. So, we went and did a Black Grape album instead.
And that's out July the 7th, right?
Something like that.
Yeah. And you now with Creation, obviously. So
Creation Management, the album's out on Universal.
Right.
Yeah.
So Alan McGee's looking after you.
Oh, Alan's been... Yeah, I mean, Alan...
Is he doing both bands? Is he doing Mondays and Black Grape?
He's doing Mondays, Black Grape, and then me.
Oh, great.
You know, so... Yeah. And... I mean, Alan, at first, right? Alan, it's funny how it all sort of came together. Alan had seen about the Black Grape, was it the Mondays? He got in touch wanting to, because he knew the Mondays needed a manager. And then I said, Alan, we've just got this guy, and, you know, we're on a 6 month with him, you know, see if it works out. Oh, right, okay. So if it don't work out, we'll see you in 6 months. In the meantime, we then got Black Mean Kermit, who was definitely doing Black Grape. So I rung Alan up and said, do you fancy looking after Black Grape? Of course, yeah, I'd love to. And then, so we're doing all that, and then the 6 month came to an end with the other people. It didn't work out, so then Alan, you know, got Black Grape, the Mondays, and me.
And what a musical lineage he's got.
Oh, Alan's brilliant. Well. I mean, he's a fantastic fucking dude. That's all, he's a dude.
No bullshit.
No. He's fucking great. He really is. He's a genuine bloke. Have you met? Do you know him?
I don't know him. I've never met him. I'd love to get him on this podcast.
Alan do it. He loves it.
I'm sure he'd have some good stories, wouldn't
fucking,
he?
You know, you got to fucking drag me kicking and screaming still. You know what I mean? But Alan, fucking, you know, it's like he's DJing. Going out DJing tonight.
He loves it.
Sean fucking loves it.
Are you not a fan of the interview then? Does it just kind of make you a little bit uncomfortable?
No, I mean, I go out and do Q&As and stuff now. I can't enjoy it. One thing that I really enjoy, which again, I didn't think I would, is they asked me to do this thing with all these university kids. I thought, I don't want to fucking do it. Music, business, me, and do like my Q&A stuff. So I did it. And all these kids was great. And I thought, you know, it's fucking, I enjoy it, so I'll do more of them. So I don't mind, you know what I mean? I don't mind.
I think with doing lectures or appearances in front of like kids is the most rewarding thing you can do is inspire young people, right?
Which, that's, you know, a real, I would have stayed away from, you know, basically I'm a bit, not a lazy cunt. It's just like, one, I don't like something that I've never done before. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
And, you're like,
and
well,
that's always
I?
The best thing. My missus always says, change is good, change is great. And I didn't like change, you know what I mean? It's like, but you know, change is good.
I read something about the first Black Grape album, about how you were saying that you'd wish that was the last Mondays album.
Well, it should have been.
Should have been. Do you have to have a different frame of mind to write for the two projects? How does that work? Because that's quite interesting to me, because they're very similar in some ways, but then they're quite different in others.
Well, the thing about with Black Grape is, with the Mondays, I have to write on my own. We Black Grape, me and Kermit, I mean, we just bounce off each other. And we both, I mean, what we do is we write cartoon short stories. You know, that's what we do. It's, you know, we take bits out of our lives, his lives, what's on the news, you know, what somebody said. And we make cartoons stories up, you know, short stories or little movies going on in our head and sort of, you know, bring it out on record.
Do you have a preference when writing?
I love writing with him.
Yeah?
Yeah, I mean, you see, what I do as well is because I'm not, I don't traditionally go, right, time to write. Here's my pad, you know, and boom, 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 boom. I don't do that. What I do is I have a teapot, right, and the teapot, I put fucking beer mats in it with a couple of lines on, anything can write on, you know, and throw it all in this teapot, whether it's for Mondays or Black Grape. And what it is, when it's time to go and start writing, I just get the teapot and take all the shit out and look at it, you know, especially on Black Grape as well. And then he comes with all his ideas, you know, or we just start, you know, get a beat up and start at it. He comes with all these bits that he's, you know, he's got wrote down in his pads, and I've got all my fucking pieces of torn up shit in my teapot.
So it's a little bit like the Burroughs cut up kind of technique to lyric writing.
In a way, you know, because
but obviously they're not random.
Yeah, I mean, what we do is, I love two liners or three liners, and then that's in there. That's the sort of the start of a story, you know. And then I can get, you know, get something out, and then, oh, right, okay, yeah. And then just build something around it. And use a personal experience, just a little bit. I mean, it's like one of the tunes, Nine Lives. That's a bit about me. It's a bit about, you know, something else. But Kermit, we put all that in and just write a song about it. That's our job, to write a song, come up with, you know. And then a lot of times they do sound very personal. You know, so that's even better, really, if it sounds personal. They do like that record, of course.
Tell me about Celebrity. I just want to power for you a few last things before we wrap up.
What, the TV stuff?
Yeah.
Well, you know, again...
Crocodile Dick, Shaun. What does that taste like? Because you just smashed... I watched the clips...
I didn't have any problem.
...when it was on TV at the time, and you just smashed through it all. Like, yeah. You just didn't even care.
Do you know what, right?
And there's so many, like, oh, I can't possibly...
You see, that's the thing about that, right? It's always like, give it in. On that, right? Here's the two differences. I mean, years before, I turned down Big Brother. And Bez went and did Big Brother, Bez won it.
Yep.
At the time, 2004, I was still sort of, well, I'm an artist, we don't do that sort of thing. And then by the time 2010 had come along, the whole game had changed. And really, you know,
you got to think of new ways to get your name out there, haven't you?
You've got to. I mean, you know, and there's new Americans. We, you know, even when started it with, you know, Rev Run and Snoop, and they're all doing stuff, you know, and reality stuff. And you've got to do it. You know, I mean, that's it. So by the time I got offered that, and it was like, well, to me, the Big Brother is, you know, you've got a bunch of people with mental health issues and throwing a load of fucking booze.
Yeah.
Now, the jungle...
Time bomb.
The jungle, right, all they do is they get a load of fucking pampered fuckers, right, starve them, make them eat shit and walk and exercise. That's it. And you sleep outside in a sleeping bag. How fucking hard is that? It's not, is it? You know what I mean? So... You know, I didn't want to do it. The wife was saying, do it, and the kids and everyone, do it. And the record company was, do it. And I would fucking do it. I did it, and I loved it. It was great.
You did love it, did you?
Yeah,
you get a kick out of it.
Fucking loved it, yeah. It was, you know, yeah. And then the people that I was in with, you know, I liked them.
Was Dom Jolly in the same one as
Dom
you?
Dom was in.
He's great, isn't he?
You know, I mean, I like Lempick, Opick. You know, fucking him. Ooh. I liked him. He's a wacky dude, you know what I mean? He's fucking wacky. You know, the guys, his family are scientists, you know. They was, you know, they had to get out of fucking some war-torn Eastern European country in the 70s, and then they sent him fucking to Northern Ireland, you know what I mean? He's going to be fucking wacky, you know. So I liked him. I like, you know, even Gillian McKeith. She's fucking, you know, a blagging woman who pretended she was a scientist by looking at people's shit. She was a nutcase. She was great, you know.
And John did it as well, didn't
and
he, John Ryder?
Oh, Johnny, well, that's why one of the reasons that convinced
Again,
me. Well, if it was good enough for fucking John, then it's good enough for me. You know, that's why I'm doing this one. Good enough for him, yeah. I'm having it.
Well, thank you very much. Cheers, John.
Yeah.
Let's talk very quickly. I want to talk about the alien stuff because on the way here, there was a girl with a patch on the back of her jeans. Really weird. Like, I'm on my way here to meet you, and she's got a patch on the back of her jeans with a UFO, and it says, "I want to believe." I was like, because I wasn't going to ask you about it, but then I thought, that's a sign that I want to, because leading into it...
Look, I've already made a cunt of myself anyway. I mean, you see, look, as soon as you touch on that, and especially me with the drink and drugs, you know, I mean, I first saw it, I was 15 years old, I'm going to see my job as a messenger boy in town. I'm going to the bus stop, and there was a little kid as well who went to grammar school in town. He must have been about 10, or not 11, 12, something like that. And it's just before 7 o'clock in the morning, we saw this thing going zip, 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 stop, zigzag, zig, stop, and then fuck off like that. And that was 1978. Now, we're not supposed to have anything like that now. I'm sure we have, but we certainly didn't then, so, you know, and I know what we saw, and not that kids saw, you know, and that was the first time I'd ever seen anything. So, you know, I was interested from that. And then about a year later, I'm stood at the height in Salford, and now what I've seen on YouTube quite a lot is these lights going across the sky that look like loads and loads of craft going really slow, something like that. And I saw that. And then at the time, they tried to say that it was the lights at Salford Rugby Club that had gone, you know, dolly, the floodlights, which is like bollocks. I know what I saw there. And then I've seen it again. When I was doing the documentary, I didn't say anything at the time because it was, again, it'd look like you're just saying it to promote the documentary. We'd just come back from Chile or wherever we'd been. And again, it's 7 in the morning. It's light. And I wake up. And on my backfield, over the fucking apple tree, right, is a craft. It looks like it's made out of Airfix kit. Right? It's even a bit wobbly, as though it had strings on it, right? This fucking thing then, it's got lights going all around it, blue, purpley A's, right? Looks like it's made out of plastic as well. So I'm thinking, sis, they fucking, you know, a production plane taking a piss. Have they got some sort of remote control? Next thing, this thing makes fucking cloud and goes off really slow over the backfield. Cloud gets more and more till you're just gone. You couldn't see it. Now, I said that on this morning. You know what I mean? On a TV, that their show. So I thought, you know, well, people just think you're a fucking dick. It don't matter. I know what I saw.
Do you have people in your family or your friendship circle who support you?
Oh,
and believe you?
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Because...
Well, my wife was laying next to me, right? And for some fucking reason, right, I went, no, don't wake her up. Don't wake her up, right? I don't know why I did that. I should have woke her up and said, look at that. I didn't.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean...
Where do you stand, Shaun? Because I want to, leading into the paranormal kind of, you know, scientific supernatural stuff, you were obviously raised Catholic.
Yeah, yeah.
You, I think, mention and sort of reference God and religious imagery quite a lot in your lyrics.
Yeah, I mean, well, going back to that first album, right, it looks like that full album, we had to purposely avoid that this time. What happened on that first album is we did about 30, 35 songs and...
Black Grape you're talking
yeah,
about.
Yeah. Black Grape album, and Gary Kirpers just happened to pick all the ones with sort of, you know, religious elements in them. So, you know, but yeah, yeah, you know.
Where do you stand? What's your spirituality? How do you define that? And do you subscribe to any organized religions? Do you are you
look,
a person
God's
of faith?
Great, religion's fucking bollocks. Even the scientific fact now is you know where science and God. A meeting, you know, I mean, with quantum physics and some of the stuff that's the breakthroughs that are happening now, if people don't know, they should fucking read. It's just whatever you, what you can think, you know, it's real, you know, it's not just us in the universe, there isn't, you know, and just because, you know, we've supposedly not invented, you know, travel that can just... open this fabric in front of us, which is a fabric, open it and make you move and pull it to you, you know, it's just because we haven't invented travel like that or warp speed or whatever you want, it doesn't mean that somebody else hasn't. It doesn't even mean that we haven't invented it from the future. I'm not even, I know what that thing was that I saw. It was a craft. I don't know if it was alien or it could have been, you know, it could have been
man-made.
Yeah. Perhaps. From when, I don't know, you know yeah. what I mean? But even if you look at all the latest research, then we do know now that time travel is possible.
What's interesting is I think in the last 20 years, technology has developed and progressed
yeah,
at such an insane rate that who knows where we will be in another 20 or 50, because if you know, you're a child of the 60s,
years.
Right?
Yeah, yeah.
So for you, things like hairdryers, televisions would have been things of the future when you first saw them, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
And now that's their antiquated... Do you know, in prehistoric gadgets.
There's more technology in that than what sent our astronauts to the moon.
He's holding up his phone, ladies and gentlemen. Yep.
You know?
Yeah.
And if you look at all the astronauts, right, from the Apollo missions, who are all on the deathbeds, all their official secrets act has now run out. Now, these guys who have got distinguished military careers, and they're so high up in the Air Force, and they've been to the moon... And now they're all talking about what they actually saw there and what they know. You know, they're not just making it up, you know, for everyone to say, well, what a fucking crazy bastard he is.
Well, they'd have nothing to gain at this stage, would they?
Absolutely, you know, so, you know.
So you're of the opinion that somewhere in the middle of science and
there's shit going on here now, right, that anyone who doesn't believe, who thinks it's all mumbo, are just seriously getting mugged off.
Well, you have to look at it like this. If you believe that in 7 days or 6 days, because he rested on the lap, a guy in the sky with a beard created everything that you see before you, that is far crazier.
Absolutely. Yeah.
With no disrespect to anyone, you know, who's tuning in, who's
absolutely,
a person of faith, but it's all in the way that you perceive the world around you, right?
Absolutely. Yeah.
You truth know. Is in the eye of the beholder.
Yeah. You know, we do make our own reality.
What have you learned, Shaun, to condense this crazy ride into, you know, a few ideas and thoughts and lessons?
It's going to get fucking freaky in the future.
It is. You're not wrong there.
Yeah, and not far off as well. You know, not that, you know, I mean, driverless cars now, you know, give that 15 years and that is just going to be normal on the road.
Yeah.
You know.
And then they'll be coming off the ground next.
Yeah, oh, absolutely. Yeah, of course. Yeah. I do believe that technology has been held back, you know, till, I mean, it's like the people that make these, right? They're the same people that make the fucking cigarettes, but it wasn't at first, but now they all know, you know, you got individual people that try to set up selling these, and now it's just the people that have gone to the market, and now the big tobacco companies, you know? It's like if when weed does become legal here.
You think it should?
Didn't one
of your family members have something with their son? And
Yes. I mean, he had cancer.
Cancer treatment.
You know, I've gone from... First of all, when I was young, drugs should be legal. All of them. Then I went to this where I didn't even want weed being legal. You know, and now I'm back to... The sort of thinking is, look, you've got to try something new and drastic, right? I mean, if you look what's happened in California and America where, you know, weed, you can now grow weed, smoke weed, go to your specialist shops and doctors, and they're getting the taxes. Whatever happens in America, whether it's 10 years, 20 years, 50 years, it will happen here. It will, it does, that's it. You know, and certain things in Europe. So we will see that, because, you know, to take it, everything out of the gangsters and all the bullshit that goes with drugs. It's got to be something new and different tried, really.
What's the most powerful drug you've ever tried, Shaun? Any off the beaten track ones?
You mean the DMT and stuff like that?
I mean, just what's the one thing that you've tried that warped your head the most and really expanded your mind in the most earth-shattering way?
Sort of DMT molecule sort of, that hallucinogenic sort of drugs, you know. I mean, back as a kid, you know, I was always out there, I suppose, but certainly about learning, I just didn't want to learn. I wasn't interested. I mean, I had learning difficulties anyway as a kid, you know. I didn't learn my alphabet until I was 26, and that was through singing it. And, you know, obviously, you know, if it teaches, you've got to get through to you. And you know, so I was pretty much closed down. And what opened my mind, this is just me, was smoking weed and having LSD. You know, that's a book. I want to read it. That's information. I want to find that out. And that's what, you know, that kick-started me. That sort of opened me up.
They're really helpful for a lot of people with mental health issues. Mm. I've read a lot of stuff about the, you know, healing powers and the positive effect that psychedelic drugs can have on people whose brains aren't, you know, perhaps wired to function in the quote-unquote normal way.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, yeah.
As a lyricist, as a songwriter, as an artist, as a storyteller, what are the things that interest you the most? What's it important for you to portray and express with your music?
Well, I always stayed away from politics, you know. I'm not clever enough to get political. I'm that sort of way of clever, you know. And I just avoided it. Now, I mean, I didn't vote till I was 51 years old. You know, I'm 55 in August, so I'm not spending that much time voting. And it was a world where it wasn't going to affect me. I mean, now with kids and everything else, I felt like I had to sort of do something. I am getting more voicing myself on political things, you know, what I think there's some fucking really injustice going on and a lot of cuts that I don't agree with and stuff. So,
it's a troubling time, isn't it, right now?
Yeah, the world, it's gone pretty fucking... I mean, it's really not much difference now than what was happening before the First and Second World War. You know, we just keep going around on this fucking hamster wheel and repeating the same mistakes and doing the same bullshit, you know, for people that seem to profit out of it. You know, what I've usually tried to do with writing and lyrics is just really make people, even though some of it might sound... but just really to make people sort of laugh or enjoy something, enjoy it just for a bit of fun. That's what, sort of like, I really come from this sort of I am the walrus cuckoo cuckoo school of writing.
Obladee, oblada.
Yeah.
And final question is, how would you like to be remembered?
Fucking hell. All right, fella, decent dude. I've got to start. I'm trying to sort of put more back now than ever before. You know,
in terms of,
well, just helping out and doing things that I should have been doing way back. Charity work, stuff like that. Or certain causes and things that you should now be involved in.
Shaun, it's been an absolute pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for your time.
Cheers.
I hope it wasn't too painful.
No, it's good.
Put her there, brother. Thanks very much, mate. Thanks very much. I got